all of you to this particular lecture series on Gandhi Science and the Future of Humanity. Essentially, this is to celebrate his 150th birth anniversary. Unfortunately, we got delayed for various reasons, most importantly, the pandemic that broke. But this particular series of lectures, and today we are inaugurating this particular series of lectures, has been supported by the Department of Biotechnology. So it's a joint program of the Indian Academy of Sciences and the Department of Biotechnology. The reason why we are organizing this lecture is that, and we call it the future of humanity, is primarily because Gandhi identified, and I quote, "science without humanity," unquote, as the cause for ills of humankind. He also said that attainment of peace is impossible except for a greater scientific precision. However, he lamented that in spite of his efforts to harmonize modern science with humanity, many people actually felt that he did not live up to science, or did not was not a friend of science. And he clarified that when he delivered a speech to a group of college students in Trivandrum in March 1925. And I quote, "It's a superstition in India that I'm an opponent." I'm not quoting him verbatim. I'm cutting out a few phrases here and there just to save time. "It's a common superstition in India that I'm an opponent, a foe of science. Nothing can be farther from the truth. I think we cannot live without science if we keep it in its right place, but I have learned so much during my wanderings in the world about the misuse of science that I have often remarked or made such remarks as would lead people to consider that I was really an opponent of science. In my humble opinion, there are limitations even to scientific search, and the limitations that I place upon scientific search are the limitations that humanity imposes on us." Unquote. And I would also like to state that in 2019, when his 150th birth, when the world was celebrating his 150th birth anniversary, in the journal Nature, there was a commentary that noted, and I quote from the commentary, that "as the world continues to grapple with how to respond to climate change, biodiversity loss, persistent poverty, and poor health and nutrition, Gandhi's commitment to what we now call sustainability is perhaps more relevant today than in his own time." I'm really glad that we are able to inaugurate this lecture series with a lecture on sustainability. And Professor Ramachandra Guha, who is today's inaugural speaker, has written books on Gandhi and has written books on environment and sustainability. Professor Guha is well known as a critical thinker, a versatile author, an anthropologist, a historian, a cricket aficionado, all rolled in one. He has written about the use and abuse of Gandhi as well. Today, he has written a piece in the newspaper that's published from Calcutta, The Telegraph, and he's written on Gandhi. And I will read two lines from his essay that I read this morning. The first one: "This ability, the ability to listen and learn, this willingness to change his views if confirmed with contrary evidence, emphatically set Gandhi apart from the other politicians of his time." The second sentence that I would like to quote is, "Reading Gandhi, researching Gandhi is to encounter a human being whom his followers claimed to be pure and perfect, a Mahatma even, but who knew himself to be fallible and flawed." It's just absolutely wonderful that we have a researcher on Gandhi who has actually written not just a biography of Gandhi, but a critical commentary, I would say, many, many pages of what Gandhi has preached and his philosophy. So it's really wonderful for me, on behalf of the Indian Academy of Sciences and on behalf of the Department of Biotechnology, to welcome Professor Ramachandra Guha to deliver this talk on Gandhi and environmental sustainability. Ram.
Thank you all for being here today. I am delighted and honored to be inaugurating this series hosted by the Indian Academy of Sciences, an organization founded by C.V. Raman, who had some very interesting exchanges with Gandhi. described in my biography. In the 1930s, Gandhi was not very well, and he was advised by a doctor to take a rest cure in Nandi Hills outside Bangalore. And Raman and his wife, Lady Raman, went to visit Gandhi. And then, of course, Gandhi, when he came to Bangalore, came to the Indian Institute of Science. And there's a very interesting conversation about science, about research, about experimentation, and also about language. On the question of Gandhi, for example, chastised Raman on the fact that he did not know Hindi, whereas his wife had learned Hindi. But those are questions relevant to Raman and Gandhi. Today I'm going to speak on Gandhi and environmental sustainability. And I'm going to begin my talk with a visit that Gandhi made to Oxford in 1931. And in the audience to hear Gandhi was an Indian student called D.F. Karaka, who later became a famous journalist in Mumbai and an admirer of Gandhi. He was also later to write a biography of Gandhi. But in this book, in a book he wrote shortly after Gandhi's visit to Oxford in 1931, Karaka said, "The students who had flocked to hear this Indian speaker came to see with the naked eye and in the flesh the man who with Christ, Lenin and Shakespeare will go down through the ages as one who belongs not to an age, but to all time." Now, this is 90 years ago, and I may be allowed to amend the company that Gandhi was keeping in 1931. Christ, yes. Shakespeare, yes. Buddha, Lenin, probably no. And I would replace Lenin maybe with the Buddha. But like Shakespeare and Christ and the Buddha, Gandhi will go down through the ages as one who belongs to all time, not just to his time. Consider Gandhi as a universal figure, as a trans-temporal figure. We are looking at his contributions in three vital spheres of social and public life. Firstly, his invention of satyagraha, the technique of non-violent resistance against brutal and coercive state authority. Secondly, his lifelong opposition to discrimination based on race, caste, and gender. And thirdly, his promotion of interfaith harmony and religious pluralism. So these three core moral principles: if you resist injustice, always do so non-violently. Always oppose discrimination on markers such as color of your skin, your gender, or your caste profile. And even if you are a deeply spiritual person with a faith of your own, whether Hindu or Christian or Buddhist or Parsi or Muslim, never see your faith as superior to another, and certainly don't promote violence on the basis of religious identity. So those were three of Gandhi's greatest contributions. But environmental sustainability? Normally was not, at least in his lifetime, no one really saw him as an environmentalist. And that's the question I want to answer today. I want to pose to you that in many, but not all respects, Gandhi's writings and his work speak to the environmental predicament we face today. Now, there is clearly a Gandhian tradition in the Indian environmental movement. If you consider the two most celebrated environmental initiatives, the Chipko movement of the 1970s and the Narmada Andolan of the 80s and 90s, they were led by quintessential Gandhian figures. If you consider Chandi Prasad Bhatt and Sundaralal Bahugula of the Chipko Andolan, or Medha Patkar of the Narmada Bachao Andolan, in their courage, their selflessness, their dignity, their resolve, and their absolute commitment to nonviolence, they are clearly working in the footsteps of Gandhi. Both Chipko and Narmada often began their programs on Gandhi's birthday, 2nd October, sometimes ended them on Gandhi's martyrdom day, 30th January. So there is a Gandhian tradition in Indian environmentalism today. But was Gandhi himself an environmental thinker? Did he, in his writings, anticipate the contours of the sustainability debate as we know it today? And that's the question I'm going to answer in my talk, with specific reference to different remarks and statements that Gandhi made through the course of the last 3.5 decades of his life. Now, at the outset, when we're talking about Gandhi as an environmentalist, I want to dispel a myth current in the environmentalist literature. This is that Gandhi's environmentalism was demonstrated in his famous book, Hind Swaraj, or Indian Home Rule, which was written in 1909. A distinguished scientist who called himself, self-described himself as a Gandhian, once claimed that Hind Swaraj gives us an alternative perspective to development. And the scientist went on to say that Gandhi's book showed us how the current mode of industrial development is exploitative of man by man and of nature by man. Now, if you read Hind Swaraj, this verdict does not stand up. The book has lots of interesting and unusual and perceptive things to say, but there is nothing at all in the 150 odd pages of Hind Swaraj about nature, environment, man's relationship with his surroundings. And there's no way, it's a complete myth, which often bruited about, but it's a complete myth that Hind Swaraj is representative of Gandhi's environmental writings. In my own research on Gandhi's works, chronologically, of the 90 volumes of Gandhi's collected writings, speeches, and letters, the first intimation that Gandhi can be claimed as an environmentalist occurs in an article of April 1913. And in this article, he makes a telling contrast between the city dweller and the farmer with regard to their understanding of the natural world. And I quote verbatim a long quotation from this article of 1913, because it is, as you'll see, very, very insightful. I quote begins, "A farmer cannot work without applying his mind. He must be able to test the nature of his soil, watch changes of the weather, must know how to manipulate his plow skillfully, and be generally familiar with the movement of the stars, the sun, and the moon. However clever a city dweller may be, every time he goes to a farmer's house, every time a city dweller goes to a village, he feels altogether out of his element. The farmer can say how seed should be sown. By looking at the stars, he can judge the direction even at night. He can make certain deductions from the voice and speech of birds. For instance, when certain birds cluster or sing together, he sees in it a sign of the approach of the monsoon or some other similar phenomenon. Thus, the farmer knows enough of astronomy, geography, and geology to serve his needs. He has to feed his children and has therefore some duties, some idea of the duties of man. And residing as he does in the vast open spaces of this earth, he naturally becomes aware of the greatness of God. Physically, it goes without saying, he is always sturdy. He is his own physician when ill. Thus, we can see he does have an educated mind." Now, this is an extraordinary statement and entirely true of the contrast between city dwellers and farmers today. My distinguished colleague, Professor Madhav Gadgil, whose work is known to some of you who are here today, once told me that in his many years of research in rural India, he did not, of course, ever meet a person who knew as much about birds as Salim Ali, or about reptiles as Romulus Whittaker, or about plants as a great biologist, a botanist. But the knowledge of the natural world was widely distributed, was widely there. Like a farmer would know, could identify maybe 60 species of birds, 50 species of plants, 10 species of reptiles. So whereas in a city dweller, Swaminathan might, I beg your pardon, Salim Ali might know 500 species of birds, but his nephew would know none. And Swaminathan would, I beg your pardon, Salim Ali would know very little about reptiles or plants either. So this insight of Gandhi, that the farmer lives close to nature and in his everyday life, he encounters the diversities and the complexities of nature much more intimately than the town's dweller, is, I think, a striking indication of Gandhi's environmental philosophy, but also something that is entirely relevant to what is going on in India today, also to Gandhi's desire to debunk the notion that the farmer was an illiterate fool. You know, many middle-class Indians still regard the farmers as unthinking, irrational, illiterate people. But Gandhi points out in this long quotation that I've read to you today, that the farmer had and has an intimate knowledge of the land, of the seasons, of birds and animals, of astronomy, geography, and geology, that actually makes him much more educated than the townsman, even if he does not have the formal degrees that all of us in this room do. The farmer is more connected to nature and the natural world, and therefore more fitted to take care of his or her responsibilities and obligations in the human world. So this quotation of 1913, which appeared in Gandhi's journal Indian Opinion, and is based on what he's seeing actually of the African farmers around him in Natal and Transvaal, is the first, you could say, environmental quote, environmentally perceptive remark that I found in Gandhi's writings. And it comes from April 1913. 2 years later, Gandhi comes back to India and he travels around India and begins to acquaint himself at first hand with economic and social conditions in the village, organizes peasant struggles in Champaran and Kheda, starts the non-cooperation movement of 1920-22, whose anniversary we're now, centenary anniversary we're now observing today. And from this deeper understanding of Indian life, Gandhi realizes, from his deeper understanding of Indian social and economic life, after his return from the diaspora, Gandhi comes to see that it would be impossible for India to emulate the models of economic and industrial development that had been followed in the European and North American world. Now, this instinctive knowledge that there are resource constraints to a densely populated, poor, colonized country following exactly the same model of development as the West is there in Gandhi, but he does not really offer an alternative model. You can't say that there's a development model in Gandhi, alternative model of sustainable development in Gandhi. And this is for two reasons. Unlike all of us here, Gandhi was doing other things. I mean, he was an activist rather than a thinker or a scientist. And secondly, as an activist, as a change maker, his focus was on ending caste and gender discrimination, achieving freedom from British rule, and promoting interfaith harmony. So you could say that the quest for a sustainable development model was understandably somewhat low in Gandhi's list of priorities. So his main emphasis was on the struggle for independence, Hindu-Muslim harmony, emancipation of women, the ending of untouchability. And given all of this, he could scarcely have had the time or leisure to chart out an alternative development model to publish in journals or books as we may have liked him to do. At the same time, scattered through his writings and speeches from the 1920s through the 1940s are clues to such an alternative path. And I'm going to now give you a series of quotations from Gandhi's works that have a bearing on our 21st century quest for environmental sustainability. Gandhi's reservations about the wholesale industrialization of India are usually ascribed to moral grounds, that he felt consumerism, greed were kind of underpinned in industrial society. But there were also markedly ecological undertones to his critique of industrialization. I'm going to quote you what, to my mind, is a remarkable statement that Gandhi made in December 1928, almost 100 years ago. I quote, "God forbid that India should ever take to industrialization after the manner of the West. God forbid that India should ever take to industrialization after the manner of the West, the economic imperialism of a single tiny island kingdom, namely England, is today, namely 1928, keeping the world in chains. If an entire nation of 300 million took to similar economic exploitation, it would strip the world bare like locusts. So in 1928, Gandhi is saying, if an entire nation of 300 million took to similar economic exploitation, took to industrialization in the manner of the West, it would strip the world bare like locusts, and China and India indeed may contribute, along with the Western powers, of course, in stripping the world bare like locusts. Now, this is a prophetic statement from 1928. And what is he saying? Western economic development was founded on a belief in the unlimited resources that nature could offer. Capital, land, forests, water, energy were, so to say, you know, available in plenty with no constraints at all. There were no limits to resource availability. Gandhi recognized that unlike England, we had no fresh colonies to conquer. But yet, he deplored the fact that we wanted to make, as he said, make India like England and America. And, you know, there's a forgotten chapter in Indian intellectual history here, which is a debate had between Gandhi's remarkable follower, J.C. Kumarappa, to whom I may come in a minute, and the industrializers within the Congress Party, like Subhash Bose and Jawaharlal Nehru. And when the National Planning Committee was formed in 1938, under Nehru's chairmanship, Kumarappa had a series of arguments about the importance of sustainability, of conserving forests, of using water wisely, of decentralizing production, of upgrading local technologies rather than a wholesale imposition of modern Western industrial technologies across India. Now, that in that debate, Kumarappa failed. And Nehru and Bose and the modernizers and industrializers had their way. And we began, particularly from the 1950s and the onset of state planning, to emulate the Western model of resource-intensive, capital-intensive industrialization. And this clearly has accelerated the process of environmental degradation. So the expansion of the industrial urban sector has involved the capture of water, forests, minerals, and fish from the countryside, leaving a trail of environmental and social devastation in its wake. Gandhi would have recognized this. He would have not been surprised by the environmental social devastation that industrial development in India has caused. In 1946, he said, "The blood of the villages is the cement with which the edifice of the cities is built. The blood of the villages is the cement with which the edifice of the cities is built." Now, Gandhi wanted economic development to be centered on the village. He thought that development and indeed political control should be bottom up rather than top down. He wanted, as he said, the blood that is today inflating the arteries of the cities to run once again in the blood vessels of the village. Preeminent here was the decentralization of political and economic control. That's what he emphasized. Hence the Panchayati Raj system, which of course has really not been implemented, though it's encoded by law and is, as Article 73 and 74 of the Constitution, does not really empower villages and panchayats to control their natural resources. But Gandhi was once accused in 1935 of turning his back on scientific inventions such as electricity. He replied, I quote, "If we could have electricity in every village home, I should not mind villagers plying their implements and tools with the help of electricity. Then the village communities would own powerhouses just as they should own their grazing pastures, their tanks, and their forests." In 1937, shortly after he moved to Sevagram in central India to devote himself to rural reconstruction, Gandhi defined his ideal village. Just listen to this description of Gandhi's ideal village from 1937. I quote, "The ideal village will have cottages with sufficient light and ventilation, built of a material obtainable within a radius of 5 miles. The cottages will have courtyards enabling householders to plant vegetables for domestic use and to house their cattle. The village lanes and streets will be free of oil of all avoidable dust. The village will have wells according to its needs and accessible to all. It will have a common meeting place, a village common for grazing its cattle, a cooperative dairy, primary and secondary schools in which technical education will be the central fact, and it will have panchayats for settling disputes. It will produce its own grains, vegetables and fruit and its own khadi. This is my idea of a model village." Now, this description of 1937 is one that resonates with our environmentalists totally, not just in India, but across the world. What do proponents of sustainable development advocate? Local self-reliance, a clean and hygienic environment, the collective management and use of forest, water, and biodiversity. Now, Gandhi also understood the problems that the village was facing. Even, you know, he didn't glorify the Indian village, for example, in the 1930s. He wanted development to be centered in the countryside, but he clearly saw that even traditional practices had to be refined and improved. One of the issues that he really worried about was the problem of soil fertility. You know, he was an enthusiastic supporter of organic manure. You know, Kumarappa himself promoted the reuse of human waste, which was absent in India, unlike China, because of caste taboo. I mean, in China for centuries, night soil had been used to replenish the soil. And Gandhi, along with Kumarappa, advocated a limited, restricted use of chemical fertilizers because of the damage they did to soil fertility. The great agricultural scientist Albert Howard, who pioneered methods of organic farming in Indore, was in touch with Gandhi. And in his own magazine, Gandhi described approvingly and in great detail the methods developed by Howard to convert a mixture of cow dung, farm waste, wood ash and urine into invaluable fertilizer. So Gandhi understood from an economic, technological, institutional point of view that there were problems with Western models of industrial and urban development. But Gandhi also, as is well known, critiqued modern civilization from a moral point of view. For him, I quote, "The distinguishing characteristic of modern civilization is a multiplication of wants, whereas pre-modern civilizations were marked by what he thought was an restriction upon and a regulation of these wants." Hence, his advocacy of voluntary simplicity at the level of the individual. It is claimed that Gandhi coined the aphorism, "The world has enough for everybody's needs, but not enough for anyone's greed." I mean, this is a line of Gandhi that you see everywhere. It's not exactly fake news, but it's manufactured. Gandhi never said those words in that order, in that precise order, but the sentiments that they convey are undoubtedly his own. So I've given you a series of quotations from Gandhi's writings to make the case that Gandhi can be considered as an early environmentalist. Someone who was deeply worried many years before climate change, 100 years before climate change became a matter of global public policy concern. Gandhi was talking about the limits to the Western model of energy and resource industrialization. Gandhi was prescribing the renewal of traditional practices of conservation, recycling, and reuse. Gandhi was asking us at the level of our individual lifestyles to think about the impact we had on the earth. For want of time, I will return to Gandhi in a bit, but I just very, very quickly like to introduce two remarkable contemporary disciples of Gandhi. In the early part of my talk, I spoke of the contemporary environmental movement. I spoke of how Chandi Prasad Bhatt of the Chipko Andolan or Medha Patkar of the Narmada Bachao Andolan were inspired by Gandhi. But at the same time, they were two close associates of Gandhi, two direct disciples of Gandhi, two intimates of his ashram, who must be considered among the pioneers of environmental thinking in India. One is J.C. Kumarappa, whom I have already briefly introduced you to, and who greatly influenced the work of E.F. Schumacher. E.F. Schumacher's Small is Beautiful, his coining of the term appropriate technology, is to a substantial degree inspired by his understanding of Kumarappa's work. The phrase that Schumacher uses, the economics of permanence, is directly derived from Kumarappa's book of the 1930s, The Economy of Permanence. There's a wonderful biography of Kumarappa called The Web of Freedom, written by Dr. Venu Madhav Govindu of the Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore and Dr. Deepak Malhan of the Institute of Management also in Bangalore. So this biography of Kumarappa, I urge on those of you who want to learn more about this remarkable, unfairly forgotten green Gandhian, a pioneer of ecological economics who worked closely with Gandhi all through the 30s and the 40s. The second green Gandhian is actually better known, but for different reasons. This is Gandhi's English disciple Mirabai, who figures in Attenborough's film. Most of you here, probably everyone listening to me today, would have seen Attenborough's film. And you remember a scene where this daughter of an English admiral called Madeline Slade arrives at the Sabarmati Ashram in Ahmedabad in 1926, touches Gandhi's feet, and Gandhi gives her the name Meera and says, "You'll be my daughter." And of course, from 1926 to the heyday of the salt, through the time tumult of the Salt March and the Quit India movement, Mirabai is always at Gandhi's side. So Mirabai's representation in the way she's been portrayed in Attenborough's film and the way she's remembered in Indian literature, including in an Amar Chitra Katha comic about Mirabai, is as an example of a rich white woman who devoted herself to this brown saint. And that's about it. But there's actually much more to Meera's life. Shortly before Gandhi died, in 1948, Meera decided that she wanted to break free of the Mahatma's shadow and start an ashram of her own. So she went to Rishikesh, the foothills of the Himalaya. And she lived in the Himalaya, in the Garhwal Himalaya, for the next 12 years. And during those 12 years, she wrote a series of remarkable articles drawing the attention of the public and of policymakers to the intimate links between Himalayan deforestation, soil erosion, and floods. Years before the Chipko movement, she talked about the fact that forest management discriminated against peasants, that it had a heavily commercial orientation benefiting plywood and paper factories and disregarded the interests of the peasants who also needed the forest. She talked about, she was an early ecologist. She talked about the dangerous replacement of oak with pine. Oak had extraordinarily valuable ecological functions. It stabilized the soil and water regime, but pine was valuable commercially. And the forest department was systematically, steadily, ruthlessly replacing oak with pine. And she talked about the ecological impacts because pine, the oak, the leaf litter that oak forest produced, covered the soil. And when the monsoon came, the runoff of water was much less, and there was a much smaller chance of landslides and floods. But with the coming of pine, the likelihood of flash floods increased. So Mirabai was really, a very important environmental thinker of the early decades of independence. And I'm going to end our discussion of Mirabai and return to Gandhi with one quotation from Mirabai from 1949. Again, a strikingly, a quotation from a very long time ago that has a strikingly contemporary resonance. So here is Mirabai from 1949. I quote, "The tragedy today is that educated and moneyed classes are altogether out of touch with our Mother Earth and the animal and vegetable population which she sustains. The world of nature's planning is ruthlessly plundered, despoiled, and disorganized by man whenever he gets the chance. By his science and machinery, he may get huge returns for a time, but ultimately will come desolation. We have to study nature's balance and develop our lives within her laws if we are to survive as a physically healthy and morally decent species." End quote. In the last part of my talk, I'm going to return to Gandhi. In the first part of my talk, I demonstrated, I think, fairly plausibly that Gandhi was indeed a precocious environmental thinker whose words and ideas have relevance to the way which we think about how we relate to nature and the world today. That he inspired thinkers and activists who took his ideas further and deeper is also a part of his environmental legacy, not just his inspiration to Kumarappa and Mirabai, but also, if I may say so here, his inspiration to modern scientists like Madhav Gadgil and the late A.K.N. Reddy, who have made major contributions to our quest for sustainable living and thinking in India today. But in this last part of my talk, I want to raise some difficult issues. Are there ways in which Gandhi limits the environmental movement? Does Gandhi, some environmentalists, there are a lot of devoted Gandhians who, as I said in my article in the Telegraph today, see no flaws in Gandhi at all. I have a letter from a friend, a Gandhian in Pune, which says emphatically, For each and every environmental event or crisis or challenge, one can find inspiration and guidance in Gandhi. So this is the belief of a well-known Gandhian thinker in Pune, namely, that for each and every environmental event or crisis or challenge, one can find inspiration and guidance in Gandhi. It's a very emphatic statement. Normally to be found among religious believers or political ideologues. Marx has all the answers. Lenin has all the answers. Savarkar has all the answers. The Buddha has all the answers. Lord Rama had all the answers. The Prophet Muhammad had all the answers. If that was not an emphatic statement, Gandhi would have entirely disapproved. I sometimes think that if Gandhi had been alive today, he might have said, "I am not a Gandhian." In my view, Gandhi does not provide all the answers to our environmental predicament, just as he does not provide all the answers to our social or moral or philosophical or political predicament today. And say that the vision of Gandhi limits the environmental movement in two crucial respects. The first is that Gandhi turned his back on the city, and so have our contemporary environmentalists. We are now a country of more than 400 million people living in cities. We are becoming more and more of an urban civilization. Yet the environmental movement is still heavily focused on the countryside. There are no city equivalents of Chipko or Narmada. No concerted civic action looking at questions of water, housing, sanitation, energy conservation, transport, and so on and so forth. How to make our cities more habitable, more sustainable, how to reduce the footprint of our cities on the countryside are not questions often asked by environmental activists. They're sometimes asked by scientists, but less often by environmental activists. And that's because Gandhi thought that India lives in a village. That's one way in which we are limited by a Gandhian environmentalism. A Gandhian environmentalism will focus so intensively on the village that it has no conceptual or epistemological room for the city in its imagination. Like the city, the wilderness has no attraction for Gandhi. You know, there's a lovely story that I'm going to tell here, which comes from the British writer Edward Thompson, an early biographer of Tagore, who knew both Gandhi and Nehru pretty well. And in 1937, when under the provisions of the Government of India Act, Congress governments came to power in 7 out of the 9 provinces of British India, Edward Thompson came here and he tried to interest the Congress leaders in the cause of saving India's disappearing wildlife. Thompson himself was a great lover of nature and particularly of wildlife. And in his travels in Bengal in the 20s, when he was teaching in Bankura College, he had, you know, experienced the beauties of and glories of unspoiled nature. He had written a novel, which was partly an indictment of the brutal massacre of Indian wild animals by European shikaris. So he was a conservationist, a wildlife conservationist. And when his friends in the Congress Party came to power in 1937, he met Gandhi and he told him, he went to Sevagram and he said, you know, your governments must do something about India's disappearing wildlife. Animal after animal is either extinct or on the danger list. This is Thompson telling Gandhi. And Gandhi joked in answer. He said, we shall always have the British lion. And then noting Thompson's disappointment, Gandhi asked him to speak to Nehru. And Nehru had a much greater understanding of the beauty and diversity of unspoiled nature. And one of Nehru's acts after Thompson alerted him was to tell Rajagopalachari, who was heading the Madras government, to put through the proposal for the Periyar Nature Reserve. Now, in Gandhi's, I mean, this Gandhi had many remarkable attributes and perceptions. His moral vision was unsurpassed when it came to human beings. But he was relatively indifferent to the non-human world. You know, his vegetarianism is an exception. Of course, he didn't eat the flesh of animals. But nowhere in his writings, unlike in the writings of Tagore and Nehru, for example, nowhere in his writings would you see a landscape described. You know, the descriptions of nature in Tagore's poems or stories, or the invocation of the Himalaya in Nehru's travel writings. You will not see this in Gandhi. You know, Gandhi was resolutely indifferent to the beauties and the splendors of the natural world. So on one side, there's the city, Gandhi has no interest in it. On the other side, there is unspoiled nature, forests, mountains, lakes, oceans, wetlands. Gandhi has no interest in that either. In between the wilderness and the city is Gandhi's terrain. And it's a very vast terrain. It's a terrain that is home to the 700,000 villages that Gandhi spoke of often and so eloquently. It's a terrain home to the vast majority of India's people even today. And it's here, in the countryside, among communities of peasants, pastoralists, and artisans, that Gandhi's life and message are of direct application in the resistance to environmentally destructive projects or in the restoration of the relationship between the agrarian economy and the natural world. And all of us, without exception, whether living in the city, the countryside, or the wild, can try and simplify our lifestyles to the extent compatible with individual circumstance, taking our lead from a man or a person who in his life himself so few demands on the earth. So there is a vast terrain in which Gandhi's ideas are indeed applicable, in which our continuing quest for a just and sustainable world can take our clues and our ideas from him. Thank you very much.
We have two questions, Ram. One is from Professor Ashok Junjunwala, who says, or who asks, given that environmental degradation has gone on and has reached unbearable proportions, what would Gandhiji's views be on today's task?
You know, I think obviously Gandhi would. The thing about Gandhi was he was a utopian thinker with pragmatic ends and means. So I think at one level he would have brought us back to what he said in 1928. God forbid that India take to industrialization of the man in the West. We will strip the world bare like locusts. On the other side, he would have looked pragmatically at the different sectors of our life. What are we doing with our forests, our water bodies, our soils, our transport systems, our energy systems, and so on and so forth. And I think, speaking here, not as a scholar of Gandhi, but as a student of India's public policy, I think it's deeply distressing that successive governments, regardless of political party, have paid inadequate attention to scientific expertise when it comes to sustainable development policy. Scientists are listened to when it comes to defense. In the time of COVID, I hope they'll listen to when it comes to health policy. But when it comes to how to sustainably conserve and manage our water, our forests, how to design a transport system that is sustainable and resource efficient, our best scientists are not consulted. And I could give many, many examples of this. You know, if you need a metro in Mumbai, the government of Mumbai is not going to, is going to give the contract to whoever chooses without consulting the scientific experts at IIT Mumbai, for example, right? When Mumbai needs water, when Bangalore needs water, they're not going to look at AK and Reddy's model of demand management and merely go for supply with devastating environmental and social consequences. So I think Gandhi, I mean, again, I think it's appropriate that I say this in Academy of Sciences. The moral outlook of Gandhi applies universally. But Gandhi did have wanted specific solutions for specific problems. And I think one of the real reasons why we are hurting down this path to devastation is because we don't consult widely enough, not just among scientists, but among the public at large.
Good. There's one more question, which is, what made Gandhi to be a village or rural center?
So I think the fact that there's several reasons for this. A very good question. There's several reasons for this. You know, before Gandhi came back to India in 1915, the Indian National Congress was an urban-centered party. It was a party of lawyers, professors, retired judges, and operating in English. Gandhi wanted to make this a mass-based party. So he changed the language of the Congress from English to the vernacular. So the proceedings were printed in Hindi, Gujarati, Tamil, Kannada, and so forth. He, of course, traveled around the countryside. He then, of course, based his home in the countryside. I think he felt, of course, demographically, that most Indians lived in the village. But the village to him was the soul of India, you know. But at the same time, the village was him not perfect. It had to be redeemed of distinctions of caste and gender. It had to overcome certain kinds of prohibitions. It had to be more outward looking. But he did feel very strongly in, as I said, in decentralized political decision making, and hence his emphasis on the village.
One last question. Can't we extrapolate Gandhiji's rural economy model to cities by dividing them into smaller self-governed green zones?
You know, that's a good question, but how do you do it? Through coercion? Well, let me say one last thing before I come to this, about the city, about Gandhi's valorization of the countryside. You know, maybe he valorized the village too much. B.R. Ambedkar famously said, the village republic is a den of iniquity. In the village, you are identified by your caste. So this question that came about a balance, you know, maybe we have gone too much in the other direction. We do need, you know, some time ago, the former director of IIT Delhi, the late P.V. Inderesan, promoted what he called geographical socialism and said there should be no city more than 1 million. You know, it's kind of consistent with what the questioner asked, that if you disperse urban development, then maybe you can have more balanced economic and social development. You can have cities with a smaller footprint on the countryside, and hence, you know, more sustainable ways of living. But you can't really impose this part. I mean, you would have to do it through gently nudging people. You know, you'd have to tell people in Karnataka, Dharwad and Hubli and Gulbarga and Bijapur must be made as attractive to those who want opportunities, because a city is a place of opportunity. I mean, a city is a place where young people want to come to, because that's where they feel they're free of social constraints. They can enact their own dreams. So I think there is a kind of mismatch between what the city does to its environment, which is the negative part, and the hope and possibility of emancipation that it offers individuals in their everyday lives, which is the positive part. And that's really the challenge facing us too.
Good. I think we will stop here. And I wish to take this opportunity to express, on behalf of both the Indian Academy of Sciences and the Department of Biotechnology, the entire audience, the fellowship and the associateship of the Academy, to Professor Ramachandra Guha for this wonderful inaugural lecture of this particular lecture series that we have started today. The next speaker on this lecture series is Professor Anil Gupta, and he will deliver a talk at the same time, 3:30 p.m. on February 13th. We have a whole series of speakers lined up, but our next speaker is Professor Anil Gupta at 3:30 p.m. And I will circulate to all of us, the announcement with details of his title and so on. Again, thank you very much for attending this, and thank you, Professor Guha, for this wonderful inaugural lecture.
Thank you.